need to educate our youth so that if someone starts having these thoughts or starts something in their brain is just off or different, that they know, oh, I just go to the doctor, I go get help, I go get here, we can fix this. You know, instead, my generation, you know, it was swept under the rug and nobody talked about it and nobody taught me in high school. And it almost killed me. It really almost did, because I wasn't educated. And we're doing our children a disservice if we don't teach them, you know, the signs and symptoms of mental health and that it's okay to not be okay.
It's Unmuzzled with Nick Alberga.
We're now into the month of February, and that only means one thing in the NHL world, the trade deadline just around the corner. Welcome to episode 26 of Unmuzzled with yours truly, Nick Alberga. At the Golden Muzzy is where you can find me on Twitter, and just judging by the action in the NHL the last little while, you can tell it's getting to that delicate, urgent time of year. Just ask the Calgary Flames and the Edmonton Oilers. I'll get to that momentarily. First and foremost, I want to tell you about today's guest. I can't wait to have him on. Such a big-time thing in the NHL world, the sporting world, the world in general, mental health awareness. And one of the biggest and the bigger advocates in the NHL world is today's guest, Corey Hirsch, former NHL netminder, now Canucks radio analyst. We'll hop on. He'll share his story. It's very powerful stuff, and it's so vital and important, as you all know, to talk about this stuff. It was Bell Let's Talk Day last week. A record amount of money was raised for that initiative as we try our best to end the stigma and grow awareness. So Corey Hirsch is coming on. You don't want to miss that. He's tremendous. He's been a massive advocate and a voice. Released a Players Tribune article a couple years back, and just it's just so integral, especially in this day and age where we live and people... I get it. You know, a lot of us do deal with stuff internally and some people don't want to talk about it, but it's so vital to talk about. It's so important to talk about. And Corey Hirsch is going to tell his story coming up in about 10 minutes from now. You haven't made it in the podcast world until you have your own promo code. Well, the time has come. I'd say I'm living the dream. Team LTD is more than just an apparel brand. It's a way of life. They represent a community of driven individuals in pursuit of their dreams. Thanks to my Muzzo20 promo code, where you get 20% off all orders, you can live the dream too. There's so much selection on there. Visit teamltd.com, fill up that shopping cart, and at checkout, rip that Muzzo20 promo code. That's MUZZO20 for 20% off again. Teamltd.com. It is really that simple. Team LTD, the official outfitter for the pursuit of your dreams. First and foremost, let's get to the Battle of Alberta, and all hell broke loose. I talked about this last week, especially with Cam Jansen, about settling the score when it came to Matthew Tkachuk and Zach Cassian. Well, they did so, and I, you know, full credit to Tkachuk for dropping the mitts, understanding the situation, knowing he had to do so, and they moved on from there, gained the respect of Cassian as well. So all was well in that world, but let's not forget the vital 2 points in the line. These two teams do not like each other, even stems back to All-Star Weekend with Drysdale, McDavid, Tkachuk. So naturally on Saturday night, all hell broke loose, and the Edmonton Oilers whipped Calgary's ass in their building, which is really, really impressive. Not to mention, I think karma's a bitch, as we know sometimes. And David Riddick, maybe next time you don't want a stick flip, because the Oilers are a little pissed off at that, and they lit him up like a Christmas tree. And Smith kicked out of the game, and then you know, Talbot kicked out, and then Riddick's got to come back in. Like, it was just pandemonium when you look at that hockey game. But I can't wait for these battles, more of them down the stretch between Calgary and Edmonton. That rivalry is back. We've been waiting a while. I'd love to see them go at it in the Stanley Cup playoffs, but only time will tell. The Pacific is an absolute zoo right now. I have no clue what's going to happen. Again, Corey Hirsch is coming up. We'll talk about the team he covers, the Vancouver Canucks. By the day, my intrigue and curiousness is growing with that hockey club. They're really damn good. They remind me of Toronto a couple years back, if not better. Elias Pettersson, I think one of the more underrated players in this league. JT Miller, you talk about last year and the offseason, what a pickup by Jim Benning. He's been outstanding coming by way of the Tampa Bay Lightning, and a trade nobody talked about because PK Subban was traded in the same day. So Vancouver's been an unbelievable story, but the Battle of Alberta, it is back, baby. I'm always fascinated by these alarm clock stories. Kasperi Scratchanen, and I called him on Saturday night, gets healthy, scratched, and then Sheldon Keefe wouldn't share why. Internal accountability is what he called it. And then we find out that Kapanen slept in for a practice. I said this a couple of years back when it came to Alex Ovechkin. It's unacceptable, especially in this day and age of phones and Androids and iPhones. A lot of people have iPhones these days. It's really simple to set multiple alarms, not just one. I don't know about you out there, and I get people are different. I mean, time management is not good for all, but I set two alarm clocks. When I really need to be up, I got my standard alarm clock and I got my phone alarm. And then on top of that, you can set multiple alarms on your phone. So it's really unacceptable. And I like the Leafs setting a precedence under this regime of Sheldon Keefe. That is unacceptable. Kapanen owned it. I think that's the last we've heard of this story. And no, it has no bearing, no impact on his trade value if, in fact, he's dealt or is dealt between now and February 24th, which, by the way, I can't see unless it's a big-time deal for the Maple Leafs, but they're so up against it cap-wise. I just don't see it. But Kasperi Scratchanen is his new name. He got in a bit of crapping, and as my co-host Gord Stellick like to say, there's so many play on words with that. Kapanen did get an assist, excuse me, in that loss against the Florida Panthers. And the other sidebar story in that game wasn't Alexander Barkov's lower body injury. I thought a gutsy win by Florida on the road. Frederik Andersen goes down, and being in that building, you could hear a pin drop when Michael Hutchinson is announced as the goalie for the second period after Andersen left after 20. The season hangs on this. I'm sorry to say, when you look at this Maple Leafs team, how important, how vital, how big Frederik Andersen truly is to this roster. I mean, with all due respect to Michael Hutchinson, I've talked about him a lot on the broadcast on Sportsnet Radio, the Fan 590. It's just, he's not an NHL goalie, and he's sort of a victim of circumstance and the fact Toronto has no money to get a backup goalie for Frederik Andersen. It's not coming internally. They've called up Kazimierz Kaskisuo. We'll see in the coming days the extent of the injury. It sounded precautionary on Monday night, albeit we found out on Tuesday Frederik Andersen was not at practice. They're calling it an upper body injury. It's just not good news for the Maple Leafs, who are struggling and fighting for their playoff lives right now. They can score goals, but they can't keep the puck out of the net, even with Frederik Andersen. Then you add the fact in that it's Michael Hutchinson. He had a .769 save percentage on Monday night, and ultimately, you hate to pin it on the goalie, but I thought the Maple Leafs were excellent. Their goaltending was very satisfactory, or unsatisfactory, I should say, and it was probably the big-time reason why the Maple Leafs ended up losing that game to Florida, a game which they dominated, by the way. The Panthers got some big-time goals, but a couple of them were really, really smelly, and that seems to be a lingering theme when it comes to Michael Hutchinson, who, by the way, I hate shitting on. I mean, it's a tough job to be a goalie in any league, never mind the National Hockey League, but he's just not an NHL goalie. And how many times are they going to go to this well of Michael Hutchinson, of Martin Marincin? It's just getting ridiculous at this point, especially when it comes to the goaltending situation. So good luck to the Maple Leafs. They're going to need it, and we'll see if Frederik Andersen returns soon. If not, they could be in big-time trouble. That's all I'm saying. Montreal assigns Jesperi Kotkaniemi into the American Hockey League, and it just, much to the chagrin of the fans in Quebec there, they went crazy. I understand it. This has Alex Galchenyuk written all over it. Granted, I like the deal. They got Max Domi, who's a better player than Galchenyuk, is on the fourth line right now in a contract year for the Pittsburgh Penguins. It has not worked out for Alex Galchenyuk, but they have to be careful with the progression here of Jesperi Kotkaniemi. I don't mind the move sending him to Laval, gain that confidence. I know he's dealt with some injury concerns this year. He just hasn't been the same player from his rookie campaign, and you're never too young to go experience life on the buses and see what it truly is, and then maybe it gives him a bit of a kick in the ass to do better at the NHL level, but I think it's an opportunity to correct things. It's not like Montreal's going to make the playoffs. Jonathan Drouin's close to returning. They got Kovalchuk. They got some assets in play by the deadline. There's no rush when it comes to Kotkaniemi. I get it, you're burning years off the contract, but just be careful. You don't want to go down the Galchenyuk route again, I think, if you're Montreal. And to me, the principal point here is Marc Bergevin again. And I don't know how long they're going to hold on to Marc Bergevin as the GM of this team, but I'll lose it if Claude Julien is the guy ultimately who loses this job, because this comes down to the general manager. Some of the drafting decisions the last couple of years, the progression, they're not good with progression of players and development. That's simply put, when you look at, you know, some different guys, and they've got some great prospects in the pipeline, but it's nourishing these kids and bringing them up at the right time that, you know, leaves you a bit dumbfounded when it comes to the decision making with the Montreal Canadiens. So we'll see what this team does over the next couple weeks leading up to the deadline. I think it's too little too late in terms of aspirations for making the Stanley Cup playoffs, but Carey Price has been fantastic the last little while. I think ultimately Montreal is going to run out of time, and I've got no problem with Kotkaniemi right now in the American Hockey League gain some confidence to come back. Speaking of confidence, Alexander Ovechkin passing Mark Messier for eighth all-time on the goals list, now 199 goals off Wayne Gretzky's record. I still think it's going to be a difficult mark to reach. Gretzky was on a different level for so many years. Ovechkin's got to play about 38, 39 and scored a 40-goal pace last I checked. It's going to be damn difficult, but I think if there's somebody who's going to do it or come really, really close and maybe be number two behind Gretzky, it is Alex Ovechkin. Very motivated, very driven player. I won't, you know, lie and say that I used to shit on this guy all the time. Finally wins the Stanley Cup. Just he loves the game of hockey, and that's what I love about Alex Ovechkin. His attention to detail. He loves scoring goals. This guy, goal 60 of his career to goal, you know, 378. Everyone counts for him. It's so vital. And he gets so fired up. I love his enthusiasm. I'm just unsure he can get to that number that Gretzky has set, because it's you talk about records that are never going to be broken. That has to be among them, at least in my opinion. I think Ovechkin will give it a great run, but it's almost insurmountable, at least in my opinion. And lastly, I want to touch on the San Jose Sharks. Tomas Hertl, ACL and MCL blown out. He is finito for the season, as they say. And Doug Wilson's in an interesting predicament, because as we all remember, that trade for Erik Karlsson means the Ottawa Senators have the unprotected first-round pick of the San Jose Sharks. So you can't really trade everything and start losing hockey games. You never want to lose and say you're losing, but you don't want to trend in that direction to bottom out and get a better pick, because Ottawa's got that pick. So I do think San Jose's got to swallow some pride here, and they're going to have to when it comes to Doug Wilson. I think you look at guys like Melker Carlson, maybe Marlowe's gone, maybe Joe Thornton. You got to do what's best for this organization. You got to find a goalie in the offseason first and foremost. I don't think it's Arundel. Martin Jones, they might have to buy him out or sweeten the pot for somebody to take him and pay a bunch of that contract that's pretty fresh. So San Jose's in trouble. This happens a lot with a lot of teams. They're a little longer in the tooth. They got to get a bit younger. And I think that'll be tenfold in terms of the progression of this team if they can get younger and faster, because quite frankly, we saw this coming for a variety of years, and I was astounded doing the numbers too when it came to San Jose. I think they've only missed the playoffs twice in the last 23 years, so this really is uncharted water when it comes to not only Doug Wilson, but this franchise in general. They've been a staple of the Stanley Cup playoffs. Doesn't seem that way this year, but it adds some intrigue, which I like, to the trade deadline, which is on February 24th. Think a name like Brendan Dillon firmly out there. Maybe it's somebody we don't think of on San Jose. I highly doubt it. I think most of their heavy lifting will be done in the offseason, but San Jose, finito, in my opinion, especially with the hurdle injury. Barclay Goodrow, with all due respect, is the first-line center of that team. Without further ado, I think it's time to send it over to the feature presentation for today's episode. He's a mental health advocate, has done so much in growing awareness in the NHL world. Now Canucks radio analyst, former National Hockey League netminder, it is Corey Hirsch. Enjoy. With Valentine's Day just around the corner, why not take your love for hockey to a whole new level? Ever tried daily fantasy hockey? It's amazing. Well, thanks to my partnership with DraftKings, you can play free fantasy hockey with a first-time deposit of $5 or more. Here's how it works. Create or log into your DraftKings account and make a deposit. New users play for free with your first-time deposit, and all users are eligible to enter. Compete against other listeners and rack up points as you battle for first place. Just go to dkng.co/muzzy to play. That's dkng.co/muzzy. Again, enter now, as this offer won't be around forever. Minimum $5 deposit. Eligibility restrictions apply. See website for details. In any given year, one in five people in Canada will personally experience a mental health problem or illness. It's as real as it gets, for me, for you, and also for today's guest. Drafted by the New York Rangers in the 1991 entry draft, the 47-year-old went on to make 108 total appearances in the NHL. His hockey DB page is incredible. Now the Medicine Hat native plies his craft as the radio color analyst for the Vancouver Canucks. It's time to get unmuzzled with former NHL netminder Corey Hirsch. Hirschy, what's going on, my man?
You know what? Quite a bit. It's, you know, doing the broadcast for the Canucks, following them around. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, it brings you back to the old days, eh?
Yeah, still in the business, right? So yeah. It's always good when you're still working.
That's a good point. How many kilometers or miles do you think you traveled in your pro hockey career? Your hockey DP page is amazing, man.
Let's just put it this way. If I'd have studied during all those miles, I could probably be a doctor by now.
You know, I was laughing too. Yeah, go ahead.
But instead, you know what I did? I played cards. I hung out. I watched movies. I could be a doctor or a lawyer by now, but that's okay. I love what I'm doing.
You know, it's incredible because there was a fellow from Laval who just won the Super Bowl, and like he's practicing to be a doctor too. Like this guy hit the jackpot twice. But you talked about sort of the spots you've been in your career. Was there any underrated spots for you? Like I'm looking at Utah, like Portland, Malmo, Sweden. Like any underrated spots?
You know what? There's a few that come to mind, and that's a really good question. So if you told me I wasn't allowed to leave Sweden and I just had to live there the rest of my life, I'd be like, okay, let's do it. You know, it's very, very similar to Canada. Beautiful country, great people. Portland, Maine was a great spot. It's like a little miniature Boston. Utah was the skiing, and then the outdoor life there was fantastic. So I've been blessed. There's so many great cities out there, so many great spots I've been to, but you know, there's a few bad ones early in the career too, when you're traveling around some of the East Coast minor league teams. So I paid my dues.
You did. And you're right about Sweden. Sweden was so nice. I did it twice. I went back a second time, Stockholm. I love that country. It's phenomenal. What was your favorite food there? Do you remember?
You know what? I think probably the meatballs.
Yeah.
they don't call them meatballs. They're like Kotbühler or something like that. I can't remember. But, I mean, we would feed, my kids were there. So they were just, that's pretty much all we'd eat. And their Christmas, they had some specialty wines and stuff that were pretty good. And they get good traditions, just good people there. It's such a great country.
Yeah, I tried the reindeer. It was a bit tough. I'm like, why am I eating Rudolph right now?
Oh, man.
I know.
Oh, I'm not going to be able to sleep now.
Chatting with Corey Hirsch here on Unmuzzled, episode 26. So last week's Bell Let's Talk Day produced record numbers, which is tremendous. I know it's sort of a loaded question, but what does Bell Let's Talk Day mean to you, Corey?
Well, it means everything because, you know, when I was at my worst, when I was really sick, laying in my bed, not barely able to get out of bed, not really even know what was going on in my brain, and just felt like I was doomed to a life of, you know, of living trapped inside my own brain. So when you're in that state, I could never even imagine a day where we could all come together and talk about mental health. Because the stigma was real back then. Like, you didn't tell anybody. You didn't talk about it. You didn't tell anybody. And if somebody thought you had mental health issues, I mean, they looked at you like you were, like you were possessed, or like you were, you were nuts, and that you needed serious help, which isn't the case. You know, it's very, so many mental health issues are very treatable, and we're in such a much better place now. Bell Let's Talk has just blown the doors off everything.
Yeah. And you know, I think I love that motto. It's okay to be not okay. Right. And I think that's sort of something to strive for, certainly in getting the word out and talking about it. But February 15th, 2017, as you know, a big day, I would say, in your life. You described your struggles with mental health in a Players Tribune article. Looking back, was that one of the most important days of your life, Corey?
Probably the most important day of my life, other than, you know, if you're looking at when your children are born.
Sure.
But, you know, but like Bell Let's Talk Day has become a day for people to come out with their own issues, right? So you get a lot more people coming forward saying they have mental health issues. But I'd like to reiterate to people that, you know, just because your story, you don't need to, it's up to you. It's your business. It's your story. Whenever you get ready to come forward with it, like I did, I was ready. People think that I just, you know, walked in and then told my story. I mean, it was 20 years before I felt safe enough and comfortable enough to tell my story. So, you know, just for people that are out there that want to, you know, that are having trouble struggling or telling their story, or still living in a bit of a, you know, a stigma and a fear, it's okay. It's all on your own time. You know, it's whenever, and you don't ever have to tell anybody if you don't want to. There's no rules. There's no anything, but just know that help and treatment is available, and that we're in a really good place now with mental health.
That's, yeah, you're right. And how are you feeling today, piggybacking off that? I'm sure, you know, working in the hockey community and just seeing the olive branch of support's been phenomenal for you too.
Oh, it's been incredible. And to be, you know, one of the biggest things that I love is the fact that active players feel like it's safe for them to come forward.
Yeah.
We had Tyler Mott just come forward with his story, Robin Leonard. And to me, that is a massive step forward because, you know, the stigma of that you couldn't win with someone that was mentally strong or had a mental health issue because you, they looked at you as mentally weak, right? Mm-hmm. Robin Leonard has blown the doors off of that. He's having another great year, one of the best goalies in the National Hockey League. And so as an active player, you never ever wanted to come forward because you didn't want your coach to think that they couldn't win with you. Well, here's the thing is that, like you said at the start of the podcast, the numbers are 1 in 5, right? 20%.
Yep.
Doesn't discriminate. Hockey player, doctor, lawyer, construction worker, whatever, doesn't matter. It, mental health doesn't discriminate. So when you look at it that way, even on championship teams, there's at least 3 or 4 guys on that team that are struggling, that have mental health issues, right? And they're still champions. Michael Phelps, with 23 gold medals, you know, comes out with dealing with depression. I'd take Michael Phelps on my, well, my swim team, not my hockey team, but unless I could teach him how to play goal, right?
That would be incredible.
But you can still be a champion. It doesn't, you know, it doesn't matter. It's just another thing you need to deal with. And a lot of us deal with it, and you can still go on and have a great life.
You're right, and that's very well put. And as I've mentioned, you've become an outspoken advocate for mental health awareness and ending the stigma attached with mental illness. How important is that role to you, and where do you want to see it grow to?
Well, I want it to grow to the point where we look at it like it's no different than a broken arm, and that our kids are educated in it. See, so I have a little bit of a chip on my shoulder with all of this because I have obsessive compulsive disorder.
Yeah,
it's very treatable. But unless you know what it is, it's hard to pinpoint, and it ruins people's lives. So why wasn't I taught this stuff in high school? Why wasn't I taught this stuff in middle school? If I was taught that stuff, I would have, you know, I would have never ended up, you know, trying to take my own life. I would have probably had a lot longer NHL career. Well, talent kind of kept me from that, but no, you know, like, we need to educate our youth so that if someone starts having these thoughts or starts something in their brain is just off or different, that they know, oh, I just go to the doctor, I go get help, I go get here, we can fix this. You know, instead my generation, you know, it was swept under the rug and nobody talked about it and nobody taught me in high school. And it almost killed me. It really almost did because I wasn't educated. And we're doing our children a disservice if we don't teach them, you know, the signs and symptoms of mental health and that it's okay to not be okay.
Yeah, you're a true inspiration, honestly, and just continue the fight. We're all around you. We're all with you, and especially under the brand of Sportsnet, we both work at the same company. You're killing it, my man. So great job. I mentioned the Canucks. This team is unbelievable right now, and it's certainly not talked about enough how good the Canucks are doing. Travis Green, I think, has done a really, really good job. But what do you make of this team and the realistic nature that they could be a Stanley Cup playoff team this year?
You know, if you would ask me that at the start of the summer, I'd have been like, yeah, you know what? They'll knock on the door of the playoffs. I don't think they'll get in.
Yeah.
That was, you know, back in the summer, I would have said that. Now I'm watching this team and I'm like, the West Conference isn't really quite that strong this year. And that's, you know, that's just the way it is. That's great for the Canucks. Most of the big dogs are in the East. So really, I'd say take a run at it now. You know, you've got a pretty good team. And if they can make a couple of deals at the deadline, add some depth, maybe a little more toughness, you got to go for it when you got a chance. The window's gotten smaller with the cap, right? Because you got to pay so many guys. Once you have success, you got to pay them so much. Then it gets harder to make a build a team. But they've got Pettersson, Quinn Hughes on entry-level deals, Brock Besser on his deal's only 3 years. Bo Horvat's got a good friendly contract. I say go for it now. You know, because you never know. Look what happened with St. Louis last year.
Yeah, you're right. And it's so funny. Like, people were shitting on Jim Benning for years, and then now that they're good, and the narrative has changed tenfold when it comes to the Canucks. But I think you're right. Now, I want to talk some goaltending with you because I don't think Markstrom and Demko get enough respect for the seasons they're having. Travis Green's been great. But how underrated is Markstrom, in your opinion? And to that point, what do you think the ceiling is for Thatcher Demko as a National Hockey League netminder?
Yeah, if I'm a team out there looking for a number one goalie, a young one, I'd probably try and start making a pitch for Thatcher Demko because they're going to have to expose one of them in expansion draft, right?
Yeah.
So this guy's going to be a number one goalie. I believe in him. I've watched him play some dynamite hockey. He's had a few, you know, games that weren't great, but for the most part, he's developing and progressing, and he'll be a number one. I have no qualms about that. So I think that's where he'll fit. Will he be elite? That I don't know, right? I mean, I think he's going to be a really good goalie. Yeah. But if I'm a team out there, that's who I'm looking at. As for Jacob Markstrom, he's flown under the radar. Everybody kind of knew, like, and you looked at him, he had all this athletic ability and talent, and you're like, why can't he put it together and blah, blah, blah. And he's now put it together with help of goalie Ian Clark, goalie coach. He's been pretty instrumental with helping these guys. But yeah, I think Markstrom is now put himself in elite category. And if this team gets into the playoffs, I don't see how Markstrom can't be at least a Vezina nominee, because he's going to be the main reason they get in.
Yeah, and that's not going to be good for negotiations. As we know, Markstrom slated to be a UFA following this season, and that's going to be a very interesting sort of conundrum when it comes to the dollar amount when it comes to Markstrom, but I think you pay him every penny at this point. You know, switching conversation, on a scale of 1 to 10, how much do you despise Peter Forsberg? I think you know where I'm going with this.
That damn Peter Forsberg.
The 94 Winter Olympics in Lillehammer. Todd Alusko is on your team, by the way, right?
Oh, yeah.
My condolences on that front. that guy is something else, isn't he?
It's 100 miles an hour everywhere. He goes to bed, the switch goes off. The minute his eyes open, the switch goes back on, and it's another 100 miles an hour.
Oh, man, the first time I met Halushko, I'm like, is this a human being? Is he real? And then I was like, yeah, he's real, and he played in Lillehammer. You played all 8 games for Canada, winning silver. I hate when tournaments end in shootouts, and this one was more of a vivid memory, of course. But what was that experience like to represent your country at the Olympics? I've been to Lillehammer, an amazing place, by the way, in Norway.
Oh, you've been okay.
Yeah,
just beautiful. And that was one, I was blessed because that was probably one of the top Olympics ever.
Yeah.
The backdrop and the setting and how they did it. And it was the last true year of non-NHL. I know they went the last year, but it was a little different. They didn't allow, you know, AHL players and all. It was the last true year of, you know, amateur players, really. And it was really cool. As far as going, it was... nothing short of incredible. One of the biggest things I got out of that for a lesson was that these other athletes that are in the Olympics, they train every day for 4 years. They train hard. Most of them live in poverty, right? Mm-hmm. Just to get into the Olympics. And then they have 30 seconds to show what they can do. And then you're like, you know, all of us hockey players, we still had NHL careers to look at and things like that. Like these other athletes, that's why you see the tears. That's why you see the elation. That's why you see all the emotion out of it, because exactly that, they're training for that moment, and they train 4 years. And like I said, it's just, they give so much to it, and that's their Stanley Cup.
It is. And so you look at those games and the hockey specifically, you win silver, but it's known for the Forsberg move. There's a postage stamp.
Oh, yeah.
As a goalie, what makes that move so difficult? Because my brother's a goalie. I know a lot of goalies, and it's just such a difficult position to play. We see it even here in covering this Maple Leafs team. But what makes that, you know, that move so difficult to gauge, Corey?
Well, because you have to play the forehand, right?
Yeah.
So you have to try and take that away, and it's the reach. It's the reach of an arm and a stick, and it's, you know, your legs only reach so far.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, you can, as a player, you can outreach with your stick. You can outreach the toe of a goalie's leg. Here's the thing, though, is how we used to play when I was stand up style, right? My butterfly wasn't very wide.
Yeah.
So. That's, you know, so back then, that's why it was such an incredible move for him to do. You know, nowadays goalies they're 6'7" and they have such long legs and such long reach, but it's a little different, but it's still a tough move to stop if executed properly. And give Peter Forsberg credit, man. what a goal. And I look at it like, you know, that goal, you know, keeps me relevant in history. It's why I'm able to, it's why I'm able to do stuff with mental health, right? It's why I'm able to have a platform. It's why, I have no regrets. And it was a great move. At least it was, you know, at least it wasn't some slug.
Oh, exactly. I mean, it's Peter fucking Forsberg, right? Like, it's,
yeah,
and that's,
exactly,
it's right. Amazing. Cause I remember like that was a goal, in 94, but even when I'm an 89 born, I used to practice that as a kid all the time, the one hander. It's so hard to pull off. Like, you have to have the softest hands, eh?
Oh yeah. And you have like strength and reach.
Yeah.
And, And you know what? And edge work.
Yeah.
You know, to be able to not fall down while you're doing it.
Yeah, it's tremendous. Did you ever get your hands on a stamp, by the way?
I did, yeah. So the next year we went over, it was at the World Championships. It was in Sweden. I got traded to Vancouver, but they sent me to the World Championships.
Mm-hmm.
And so I ended up sending a bunch of postcards back to buddies with me on the stamp. Yeah.
You can laugh about it now, right?
Oh, God, yeah. This, what, 25 years ago now. So
that's true.
Now it's pretty cool to just... You know, it's nice to be remembered, right?
Yeah.
I mean, that'll go down as one of the greatest goals in Olympic history.
You're right. And we don't have to remember the goalie.
Yeah.
Mike Smith, Cam Talbot, that scrap was something special. Was there a time in your career where you dropped the mitts at all? And what's it like for a goalie? Like, is it frowned upon in the locker room? Like, hey, don't drop the gloves unless you really, really have to?
No, everybody loves a good goalie fight. Yeah. My attitude, though, was not to try not to get my ass kicked. I live by that. So, you know, fighting for me, getting beat up probably wouldn't have helped anybody or anything. So I went to center ice with Corey Schwab once in junior. You know, we wrestled a little bit and then the refs got in. But, you know, Schwabie held a grudge for the next 15 years on me. He didn't like me. And then now we're buddies. So it's all good. But he's a great guy. Doing an awesome job too in Arizona as a goalie coach. So that was probably the closest I got to a goalie fight. I mean, I jumped on players and, you know, you do stupid stuff, but then your defensemen come in, right? So,
yeah.
But probably the best goalie fight I ever saw was Hexy and Felix Potvin.
Yeah.
Because nobody expected Felix Potvin to, you know, we thought he was going to get destroyed, and he ends up just absolutely giving it to Ekstall. And it was just a great tilt. And then the other one I remember was Byron Defoe and Ole Kolzig laughing while they're punching each other in the face because they were best men at each other's weddings.
And God rest his soul as well, Ray Emery, right? I mean, he was probably
Ray
the king.
Emery. He was a feisty, yeah.
Oh, he can lay them, you know.
And
like,
tough.
Yeah, he would fight players. I mean, that's how tough he was.
Yeah, yeah, right. I mean, he was, yeah, no question. See, and again, me against Ray Emery, it wouldn't have been good, so.
Yeah, that's true.
I got my ass kicked.
You're right, my man.
Stay in my net.
I like that. I've really appreciated your time here, man, and keep kicking ass in terms of you know, mental health and raising awareness. You're killing it, and it's not going unnoticed, by the way, so I appreciate your time and talking about Todd Halushko against your will. I appreciate it, man.
No, you know what? Thank you for giving me the platform to be able to talk about it. And we're all, you know what? I go by the motto, we're all in this together, because we're all affected by it in some way or another. And that we're doing we're starting to get to a point where we're getting there. It's still a long ways away, but we're getting there. So thank you.